since Carl Schmitt had been one of my professors at the University of Pennsylvania, I felt that when my fellowship was over, and I returned to Philadelphia, as I knew I was going to do, I would try to work with Carl Schmitt. And that's exactly what I did, and began working with him in 1944. And did some work with the bubble flow meter and the monkey, measuring not only blood flow but also oxygen consumption in the case of the monkey under situations of anesthesia, convulsions, and the action of certain drugs. But during all this time, I kept feeling that it would be much more important, much more interesting, if one could study the circulation of the human brain, because the human brain is so different from the brain, even of the highest primate, in terms of its ability to experience ecstasy and depression, its ability to imagine, its ability to think, its ability also to undergo changes from infancy to adulthood that were remarkable in terms of the capacity to develop new behaviors. And also that the human brain was subject to disorders, diseases, which are not easily reproducible in animals. So for all of these reasons, I thought that to study the cerebral circulation in the human brain, in the human being, would be a very important thing to do. The Fick principle is based on the conservation of matter, the conservation of oxygen, let us say, across the lung. If the blood flow, if one takes the blood flow across the lung and multiplies that by the difference in oxygen content of the blood flowing into the lung and flowing out of the lung, namely the arteriovenous oxygen difference, the product of the blood flow and the AV difference will give one the total amount of oxygen taken up by the lung, therefore by the body, and the blood flow through the lung would be equal to the blood flow through the body, and that would be the cardiac output. And that was the Fick principle, a very simple, by hindsight, self-evident principle, which no one had thought of before. Now, using the Fick principle in the case of the brain, one would need to know the blood flow and the arteriovenous oxygen difference, in which case one could calculate the oxygen consumption, or one would need to know the arteriovenous oxygen difference and the oxygen consumption, in which case one could calculate the blood flow. But if one assumed one or the other of these variables as being constant, then one could calculate a measure which was not an absolute measure, but a partial, but a relative measure for blood flow or oxygen consumption, if those assumptions were correct. In the case of oxygen, one could never be sure that the brain was not using oxygen at a different rate to perform the function that one was measuring. In the case of an inert gas, the uptake of an inert gas by the brain would not be dependent upon whether the brain was active or inactive, whether it was asleep or in coma or in the resting state. It would depend simply upon the size of the brain, the solubility of the gas in the brain, and the diffusion processes which allowed the gas to leave the capillary and go into the brain. And these were physical parameters which would not be dependent upon the function of the brain. So I sought around for an inert gas to use, and nitrous oxide seemed to be the most amenable to this. It had been used by Krogh and others to measure other physiologic functions. And so I did a study on a human being who volunteered for this by inserting a needle into the internal jugular, as the people in Boston had done, and another needle into an artery, and pulling blood from both of these needles at the same time that the individual was breathing a low concentration of nitrous oxide, and allowing this inhalation of nitrous oxide to go on for 20 minutes or so. And when I analyzed the blood for the arterial and the venous blood for nitrous oxide, what turned out to be a very nice smooth curve for the arterial blood flow, which rose rapidly and then leveled off, and for the internal jugular nitrous oxide, which rose more leisurely, but eventually came to equilibrium with the brain, and in about 10 minutes, calculation indicated that the brain was in practical equilibrium with the venous blood which was coming out of the brain. In other words, the process of equilibration was 95% complete. Well, now the arteriovenous difference was no longer a constant figure as it would be for oxygen, but it was a variable. So one simply integrated the arteriovenous difference for nitrous oxide over a period of 10 minutes, which gave one the loss of nitrous oxide from the arterial blood to the venous blood to the brain over that period of time. And then at the end of that period, at the end of 10 minutes, one took the venous concentration and multiplying that by a factor which took into consideration the differential solubility of nitrous oxide in brain and blood. Using that factor, called lambda, the concentration of nitrous oxide in the brain, the average brain, could be calculated. And that divided by the arteriovenous difference gave one the blood flow. And since the numerator was a concentration and not a total quantity, the blood flow ended up not as a total blood flow, but as blood flow per gram of tissue or per 100 grams of tissue per minute. And that was a highly rewarding finding. And it made it obvious that one could use those principles to measure the blood flow in the human brain. And shortly thereafter, after I did the first experiment, I reported it to Carl Schmidt, of course, and he suggested that it would be nice to validate this method by comparison against the bubble flow meter. And I agreed that that would be nice to do. So Carl set up monkeys with the bubble flow meter, and I set up the nitrous oxide technique in the monkey, and we measured both functions. We measured the blood flow with both the nitrous oxide technique and the bubble flow meter technique. And there was a good correlation between the two. And from that, it was possible to say that the nitrous oxide technique did give a valid quantitative estimate of blood flow in the primate brain and in the human brain. A young postdoc in Wade Marshall's laboratory by the name of William Landau, came to see me with an idea of his wanting to measure regional blood flow in the brain. He realized that it wasn't enough to measure total blood flow. It was important to measure regional blood flow. And he asked if he could work with me and if I could suggest how he might go about doing this. I showed him this equation in the 1951 review and said, it is possible to measure the distribution of a radioactive gas in the brain by means of autoradiography. People were slicing tissue with radioactive tracers in them and laying them on plates, X-ray plates, and measuring the amount of radioactivity. And we could do the same thing. I said, it's going to be a lot of work because we have to find a gas that we can use which will be radioactive and not break down, and we have to be able to do this whole thing in a frozen state so that the gas won't volatilize. And we're going to need a lot of help. So Landau recruited Bud Rowland, Lewis Rowland, to this project. It's interesting that Landau and Rowland became two of the distinguished professors of neurology in their career, one in New York at the Neurologic Institute, and Landau at Washington University. Sokolov had come from the University of Pennsylvania, where he worked with me on the nitrous oxide technique, and came down to Bethesda and was working on number of his own ideas, but he willingly joined in to the studies that we were doing on regional blood flow. And we also recruited Walter Freigang, who was another member of the staff of the neurophysiology laboratory. And we didn't have access to a microtome that would cut through the whole head. There were such microtomes, but it would have taken a long time to order one and to get to use it. Instead, I think it was Walter Freigang who came up with the idea of using a bandsaw, which we bought from Sears Roebuck. We dissolved the radioactive gas, which was complex gas, iodomethane. We allowed the animal to, we did not have the animal breathe it, but we dissolved the gas in saline and injected it intravenously and measured the arterial concentration of this gas. We froze the brain and we sliced the brain with a bandsaw and then applied each slice to an X-ray film and packed the whole thing away in dry ice because we were dealing with a gas which would volatilize otherwise, and then allowed that configuration to lie in a dry ice box overnight, or for however long it took, maybe 12 hours, 15 hours, 24 hours. And then we developed the films. And the density in the film was, of course, proportional to the amount of radioactivity at that particular point. And so by measuring the density, we could calculate the concentration of the tracer at that point in the slice. We had to calibrate the slices, and we did that by using standards with various concentrations of tracer, which we inserted into the frozen head, and those standards were also sliced in the bandsaw, and they also came out on the X-ray film. So in that way, we could calibrate the concentration in the slice against the density in the film, and from that curve, we could derive the concentration in the slice for any density. With that, and with the history of the arterial concentration of the tracer, and knowing the solubility coefficients, with a tracer which was not limited by diffusion, we could calculate the blood flow. And where one dealt with tracers which were limited by diffusion, that required a somewhat more elaborate calculation, which depended on the calculation that Krog and Bohr had made for oxygen, but which I was able to transform into a comparable calculation for an inert substance, which would not be a steady state situation, but would be gradually coming to equilibrium. Well, actually, the nitrous oxide technique was interesting because it was the first quantitative measurement of blood flow through the brain as a whole. But it in itself did not really have a very important impact on the field. It was the regional blood flow which opened up a whole interesting area, which is still going on apace. And from the autoradiograms, the next step was to apply this technique to human beings. And that waited for appropriate techniques for measuring the radioactivity in regions of the brain. And the first group to attempt this were the group in Sweden and Denmark, Lassen and Ingvar, who used counters on the outside, which simply measured the radioactivity coming from gross regions of the brain, and from that could calculate blood flow in large areas of the brain. And that became better resolved by the use of finer techniques until single positron emission tomography was developed, and that permitted a much more definitive measurement of concentration of a tracer in the brain. As far as the influence that you say I had in the field of neuroscience and psychiatry, That, I think, I would have to attribute entirely to Dr. Felix and the National Institutes of Health, who together appointed me as the first scientific director of the new Institute of Mental Health, and for that matter, of neurologic disorders as well. And that gave me a remarkable opportunity, which no one had had before, which, as Bob Felix said before I came down to Bethesda, an opportunity to lead the most important research program on the brain that the world has ever seen. And it was certainly the largest. Whether it was the most important was something that we had to satisfy ourselves about later. But that position, of course, gave me great leverage, and it permitted some of the ideas which I had been nursing for some time to be expressed. But the intramural program of the Mental Health Institute was not going to be a monolithic program in biology. The first laboratory which I established, interestingly enough, was the laboratory of socio-environmental studies. And I did that because that was the field that I knew least about. And it was a field that I wanted to make sure we had represented in the intramural program. In addition, there was already on board an outstanding sociologist of mental illness, John Clausen, whom I immediately appointed as head of the Laboratory of Socio-Environmental Studies. And recognizing the importance of basic research, I felt that the most important thing that we could do was to initiate a series of basic research laboratories. And I proceeded to recruit for the heads of these laboratories. The Laboratory of Neurophysiology had some of the brightest people working in it. Well, I've already mentioned Landau and Roland. Ed Everts worked with Wade Marshall. Eric Kandel worked with Wade Marshall. And out of that laboratory came some of the leaders of neurobiology and neuroscience today. Linus Pauling told me about Alex Rich, said he was one of the brightest men he had ever had working with him, and gave him a very good recommendation. And so I appointed Alex Rich. And Alex Rich developed a very interesting laboratory of basic physical chemistry. At one time, he had Francis Crick working there as a visiting scientist for 6 months or so. I suppose the most insightful appointment that I made at that time was to recognize Julie Axelrod as a great mind and a very productive scientist. Axelrod came to see me once in 1952, and I knew him from the Heart Institute, where he worked with Brody. But he came to see me on another mission, and this was to inquire as to whether there were opportunities for him in the Mental Health Institute. He was already very highly productive. I mean, a PhD is just some formal appendage that one has that recognizes that one was fortunate enough to go to school for a certain period of time. And Julie didn't have that good fortune. But he did get a PhD eventually, while he was in our institute. But then, of course, in 1956, I had done as much as I cared to do about recruiting and planning and developing the basic research program of the Mental Health Institute. And at that point, I asked Bob Felix to be relieved of that job because I hankered for the laboratory. I wanted to go back to the laboratory and to continue to do some research, do full-time research. And Bob was very understanding and said absolutely he would make it possible for me to do so. So I went back into the intramural program, became chief of a new laboratory called the Laboratory of Clinical Science, which was to blend basic research with clinical research. And into that laboratory came Ed Everts and Julie Axelrod and Lou Sokoloff and Irvin Copen. Just to name some of the leaders in that area. And all of these people were very competent in basic research. Some of them had clinical background and a clinical interest, like Copen and Sokoloff. Ed Everts was a card-carrying psychiatrist, although he was probably the most basic of all the people in terms of his interest in neurobiology. And it was in that laboratory that Julie Axelrod did his great work on the metabolism of epinephrine and norepinephrine and their inactivation by reuptake mechanisms. Through the 1950s, there was a feeling on the part of many people, but by no means all, that genetic factors operated in schizophrenia. And this was based upon the fact that schizophrenia ran in families. This was known even at the time of Kraepelin and Bleuler. And both of these men thought of a hereditary element in schizophrenia on the basis of the familial tendency. But the familial tendency in schizophrenia didn't prove that genetic factors operated because families share a lot of environmental factors. There are a lot of disorders that run in families that are not genetic. Pellagra ran in families and was thought to be, by some, a genetic disease until it was discovered that pellagra was a dietary deficiency, and the reason it occurred in families is because families shared the same diet. Twin studies were perhaps more convincing, and these were the studies of the standard studies of the difference in the coincidence of schizophrenia in monozygotic versus dizygotic twins. And there had been a number of twin studies, and in general, taking into account certain methodological problems and errors, one could say that the twin studies indicated that in monozygotic twins, there was something of the order of 50% concordance for schizophrenia. Whereas in dizygotic twins, who were simply related as siblings are related, but happened to be born at the same time, the concordance rate was the same as it is in siblings, around 10%. Now this is very suggestive of the operation of genetic factors, except for the observation that many people made that monozygotic twins share much more of their environment than do dizygotic twins. They're paraded in a single double perambulator. They're dressed the same. Their friends can't tell them apart. They live in the same room. They go to the same class. They have the same friends. They sleep in the same bed as opposed to dizygotic twins. And to what extent the concordance rate, the high concordance rate in monozygotic twins is a result of genetic factors, and to what extent it results from the shared environment is open to question. On the other hand, adoption studies might be able to separate the genetic from the environmental variables. And in that review, I suggested an adoption study that might be used, and that would be an examination of the biological relatives and the adoptive relatives of individuals adopted at an early age who became schizophrenic in later life. And after pointing out all of the ascertainment biases and the selective bias and the subjective bias that would occur and had occurred in previous studies, the kind of study that I was hoping to design would be one which would avoid all of these, and that would require a national survey, a national study, starting with a total sample of adopted individuals and then looking among them for adopted individuals who became schizophrenic, instead of starting with schizophrenics who had been adopted, which would give one a very biased sample. And it was obvious that it was going to be extremely difficult to pull together a large sample in Washington or even in America. We heard about the Danish records, which were kept by the governments and the communities in Denmark and had been kept for many years. And I went over to Copenhagen around 1962 and visited with Fini Schulzinger, who was the chief of psychiatry at the big hospital, the Kommune Hospital in Copenhagen. And Schulzinger described the records that they had, which I felt would fulfill our needs. And we talked to the authorities who maintained these records, and we got their cooperation for a collaborative study where we would have access to these remarkable records with our assurances of complete confidentiality. We ended up in the Copenhagen sample with about 5,500 adoptees. And now the task was to find how many of those had become schizophrenic, because the idea was not to find schizophrenics who had been adopted, but to find adoptees who had become schizophrenic. This would avoid ascertainment bias and selective bias and a number of other biases. Fortunately, there are other records in Denmark. The psychiatric register, which has the name and information about anyone in Denmark who has ever been admitted to a mental hospital. The hospital records were abstracted and edited to remove any contaminating information about mental illness in the parents and siblings and so on. And then we individually went through these and made our own individual diagnoses. And we had decided that we would use, in this very fuzzy category called schizophrenia, we would accept as schizophrenia tentatively what the American Psychiatric Manual diagnostic manual called schizophrenia. This was called DSM number one, diagnostic statistical manual, published by the American Psychiatric Association. And there they described three kinds of schizophrenia. Chronic schizophrenia, which was the kind which Kreplin called dementia praecox and which Bleuler called schizophrenia. There was latent schizophrenia, which Bleuler had described as a marginal kind of schizophrenia. And then there was acute schizophrenia, which was an acute psychosis, which in cross-section resembled schizophrenia, but had an entirely different kind of course. In any case, we tentatively would call each of these schizophrenia, and we would select people on that basis. And if we would each make individual diagnoses, and then we would make a joint diagnosis in which we all had to agree. And if we all agreed on a diagnosis of schizophrenia, that person became a proband, an index proband, because they were the main basis of focus of the study. We then selected a group of comparable control adoptees. For each index adoptee, we went back to the adoption records and we found another adoptee born around the same time, the same sex, reared by people of the same socioeconomic class, and who stayed with the biological parent or parents for a similar period of time. So this was a case-controlled study, each case being matched by a comparable control. Now we had to find their families, their biological and adoptive families, for the study that I was interested in doing. And that's what I'm going to talk about. In order to do this, we were fortunate that in Denmark there's another register, which they call the Folkeregister, the Folk Register, which is a population register, which has in it the name of everyone who lives in Denmark for more than a few weeks or a few months. From the adoption record, which would give us the name of the four parents, we could go to the Folkeregister and find the other children which these parents had with other partners. And this gave us then the siblings and the half-siblings of the adoptees, on the biological side as well as on the adoptive side. And this gave us then a substantial number of biological and adoptive relatives, close relatives, where we could then go back to the psychiatric register and find those relatives who had been admitted to a mental hospital. And whenever we found any information about a relative, this information would be abstracted by psychiatrists whom Schultzinger had recruited to work with him on the gathering of the data, and the abstracts would include the usual kind of information about the symptoms, the course, and any other observations that the hospital made on the illness and the disturbed behavior of the individual. These observations were abstracted by a psychiatrist who did not know the identity of the individual or whether he was a biological or adoptive relative of an index case or a control. And then they were edited to remove any information about other relatives who might be ill, and so that all that was left was information about that relative and nobody else. And then we read each of these abstracts and made individual, independent, and consensus diagnoses. And when we had done all of that, we broke the code and assigned the individuals to one of four groups: the biological relatives of the schizophrenic adoptees, the biological relatives of the control adoptees, and then the biological, and then the adoptive relatives of the index and the control adoptees. And then we asked, where does schizophrenia come? And we found in that study, right off the bat, that all the forms of schizophrenia that we had decided to include in what we call the schizophrenia spectrum, those forms of illness were concentrated very significantly in the biological relatives of the schizophrenic adoptees, and not in their controls, and not in the adoptive relatives, except for acute schizophrenia. The acute schizophrenic adoptees did not have any schizophrenia in their biological relatives. So that even in that very first study, we raised the question as to whether acute schizophrenia was properly a form of schizophrenia, whether it was not simply an acute psychosis of unknown origin. But even the information we had was not enough, because what about the patients with schizophrenia or with latent schizophrenia who never saw the inside of a mental hospital, who were treated on the outside by local physicians, or who were not treated at all? So we decided it would be important to do interviews of these people. And we were fortunate to get Bjorn Jakobsen, a young psychiatrist, who was willing to interview these relatives, and he spent 2 years doing it. And it was necessary to get their informed consent, so a letter was sent to all of the biological and adoptive relatives of the control and index people in the Copenhagen sample, saying that your name has come up as a result of a very complicated procedure, which was true, and we're doing a study on environment and illness, and we didn't mention genetics, and would you like to participate? And in that way, he eventually got 90% of the people who were still alive and living in Denmark or living in Sweden and Norway, because he went to the neighboring countries to find people who had emigrated there. And he was able to get 90% of these people to willingly cooperate in an interview. And now we found a lot more information. We found somewhat more schizophrenia than we had found before, in that some of the schizophrenics had never been in a mental hospital, and we found a few more of those. But the latent schizophrenias, we found a great number of those who had never been in a mental hospital, and the schizoid personalities also. When we analyzed those, the interviews, we found that this confirmed the hospital study. Chronic schizophrenia ran in the families of the chronic schizophrenic adoptees, ran in the biological families, and latent schizophrenia ran in the biological families of the adopted schizophrenics. But schizoid personality did not, any more than it ran in the biological families of the controls. And acute schizophrenia, again, did not occur in the biological relatives any more than it did in the controls. Then, having done Copenhagen, we thought it would be worthwhile to do the rest of Denmark. And so in 1975, when we published the interview study, we began to collect the data from the rest of Denmark, which we called the provincial sample, because it came from the provinces outside of the Copenhagen province. And now we could combine the two studies and come up with a national sample. And there we had enough cases and enough information that we could speak pretty definitively, saying that there is a significant incidence of schizophrenia in the biological relatives of schizophrenic adoptees. There is also an incidence of latent schizophrenia in those relatives. And otherwise, the rest of the schizophrenia spectrum we have not yet found to be significantly concentrated in the relatives of schizophrenics. We were thinking about the problem of perinatal factors, intrauterine factors, and early mothering as being important in the etiology of the schizophrenia. Until it occurred to us, how would we go about separating that, or how would we go about controlling that variable? When we realized that we had a remarkable sample in our study, which one doesn't usually have outside of adoption studies, and that is a large number of half-siblings. As a matter of fact, in the Copenhagen study, we had many more half-siblings than we had full siblings, for obvious reasons. In this big city, these children are born as a result of one-night stands, of chance meetings between the biological mother and the biological father, who then go their ways and have children with other partners, producing a lot of half-siblings. And because a man can produce more children than a woman, we had an especially large number of paternal half-siblings than maternal half-siblings. Well, the paternal half-siblings are just what we needed, because these people did not share the same uterus or the same perinatal factors or the same early mothering as the adoptee. The only thing they shared was the same, was half of the genetic pattern which they got from their common father. And so the question was, what happens if we look at the paternal half-siblings? The paternal half-siblings showed the same thing that the maternal half-siblings showed, a higher concentration of schizophrenia in those who were related to a schizophrenic adoptee. Well, I think that environmental factors are important in the etiology of practically all schizophrenias. I doubt that there is a form of schizophrenia which is entirely genetic, or in which the genetic factors account for 95% of the variants. I think that environmental factors play a very important role in schizophrenia. In any case, because of criticism that we got from a number of people and from Ted Litz, who didn't like our studies because he seemed to read them as being against the presence of environmental factors in schizophrenia, we kept pointing out that our observations did not deny the importance of environmental factors. They simply demonstrated that genetic factors played an important role, but genetic factors were not the whole story, and we believed that environmental factors played an important role. And they could have been the environmental factors that Litz had studied, the schizophrenogenic mother, the schizophrenogenic parents, so on. Although we did not feel that there was any convincing evidence for that. I'm not sure that we know what they are. They may be interpersonal, they may be parental, although the evidence for that is woefully inadequate despite a great deal of effort to find it. It might be viral, it might be autoimmune, might be dietary, a lot of environmental, might be birth injury, a lot of environmental variables may be operating. We have very inadequate evidence that one or another of these does play an important role. But these environmental factors have to operate on a on a susceptible genetic basis. Now, are there forms of schizophrenia where the genetic factors are minimal, are insignificant, and where most of the variance is accounted for by environmental factors? There may be. In every study of schizophrenia in families that has been done, including our studies in the biological families, about 50% of schizophrenics have schizophrenia in their close relatives, but 50% don't. In our study, just exactly half of the Copenhagen sample and of the provincial sample, just about half of the schizophrenic adoptees have schizophrenia, one or more cases, in their biological relatives, but the other half have none. Now, this suggests to people immediately that we're dealing with two quite distinct disorders, one a familial disorder and one a non-familial disorder. It's not as simple as that. Lauren Ingram has done a careful statistical analysis of the data available and finds that it's still compatible with probability that even though genetic factors may be operating significantly in all schizophrenics, that only in 50% will it show itself in other members of the family. We don't really know the answer to that, but let us say that there may be two forms. One has to spend a lot of time simply on defining what the problem is that one is addressing. What is schizophrenia? How do we recognize schizophrenia? And then, because each of those problems has a penumbra of uncertainty, the data have a penumbra of uncertainty too, and so the statistical significance of the results is not nearly as great as it is in the case of laboratory experiments. So that the studies require larger and larger samples, or they require repetitive measurements, various devices to increase the precision of the final result. But the final result, when it comes, is just as exciting as the results in a physiologic experiment. Just as exciting in terms of the gratification in having a result, but even more exciting in terms of the immediate implications. That is, one doesn't see the immediate implications of a study of cerebral blood flow, but one sees the immediate implications of a result in an adoption study if one finds, for example, that the disorder in question, schizophrenia, for example, runs only in the biological relatives of people who were separated from their biological relatives at an early age, lived with another family, and then developed schizophrenia at the age of 20. That means something very important and very dramatic. It means that genetic factors play an important role. And that is intellectually satisfying, but also socially significant and important. The bridge between neuroscience and behavioral science. That is a very important link, and it's one that tends to be ignored or devalued as neuroscience grows in stature and importance. And I think today it's especially important not to forget that that bridge exists, and it's important to maintain the traffic across it, especially in this era of molecular genetics. Now, molecular genetics is a fantastic development, great, powerful development, which someday is going to give us a map of the human genome, which will lay out the all the possible genetic bases of a wide variety of disorders. But given that, I think there is, unfortunately, a tendency in the minds of the people who are working in the field and are appropriately excited by the field to believe that molecular genetics is the answer to everything, without realizing that there are millions of processes that take place between the gene and the final phenotype, between the gene and the behavior which the gene has controlled initially. There is a fantastic interaction between gene products simply in the process of embryology. When one imagines the complexity of blood vessels growing to all the various organs in the body and nerves going to various parts of the body and afferent nerves coming into the brain and hooking up to appropriate neurons in the brain, how does all that happen? It's not all written in the genes. It can't all be written in the genes. What happens is that the genes produce products which come out at certain times. These products influence the action of other genes, the expression of other products from other genes. These products interact with each other. They affect thousands of different processes. And what we end up with is a fantastically complicated resultant of initial genetic inputs and a hugely complicated process of interaction between genes, gene products, and the local environment of cells and the environment of the developing organism. And we can't ignore one part of this process and say that if we study, spend all of our time and all of our funds in one area, we will eventually come up with an answer to the other areas. Or we will eventually come up with an answer to to the problem of the disorders of the mind or to an understanding of behavior. Psychology is still a very important partner in this development and in these studies. And recently psychology is taking on a new activation, and with the development of cognitive psychology, with the development of psychologists who work in that bridge between the neurosciences and psychology, I think we can see some hope. There are many neurobiologists who feel that psychology has come along very haltingly in the past 20 years while neuroscience was developing fantastically. And I, to some extent, I feel that they may be right. But psychology is dealing with fantastically complex processes that are not easy to clone and not easy to dissect. One can only see a greater fulfillment and a greater activity and a greater gratification in the future. I think we are in this one area of science, neuroscience and behavioral science and their interaction. I think this is one area today where we can look forward to tremendous progress and tremendous beneficial developments. I wish I could say the same thing about the rest of our society, but unfortunately, I can't be as certain there.